Morning, everybody. Morning. Did you guys have a good 4th of July? Woohoo! Let off some fireworks. Well, we're glad you're here. This is a foot stomping, hand clapping song we're going to start with. It's new, so we hope you participate and enjoy worshiping.
Yours will be the only name.
only name that matters to me. Yours will be the friendship and affection I need to feel my father smiling on me. The only name that matters to me. Yours is the name, the name that has saved me. Mercy and grace, the power that's forgave me. And your love is all I ever needed. When I wake up in the land of glory and with the saints, I will tell my story. There will be one name that I have proclaimed. When I wake up in the land of glory and with the saints, I will tell will be the only name that matters to me, the only one whose favor I see, the only name that matters to me. Yours is the name that has saved me, mercy and grace, the power that forgave me, and your love is all I
God bless you all. It's time to greet one another like your brothers and sisters. That's an order. Good morning. Good morning, Calvary Chapel, Roseville. How are we doing today? We are here. We are awake. We are ready to soak in the word. All right, let's go through some of these announcements. If this is the first time you're here, we are delighted you're here. Stick around. There's free bagels and coffee and Slurpees and a bunch of stuff in the back. Okay, so not the Slurpees, though. So let's go through some of these. We got Bible studies throughout the week, and due to the 4th of July being on the week we would normally meet, this is for the ladies, we will meet on Thursdays, July 11th and the 25th. 10 a.m. or 7 p.m., so morning or the evening. So that would be not this Thursday, correct? Let's see, this is... He looks at me. Please join us for our study. We will now meet on the first... Here's what it says, though. I'm just reading, okay? We will now meet on the first and third Thursdays of the month, which would not be this Thursday, correct? This would be the second, though. Okay, anyways, the men, it's much easier for the men. We just meet on Tuesdays, okay? Jeremiah 45 and 46, and Wednesdays is the Bible bus. Luke 19, and there is childcare on that day for the Bible bus. A big thank you for all those who helped with the fireworks, clapping. And if anybody did not help out, you missed it. It was great. The weather was cool. It was wonderful. It was wonderful. It was the best. So, big thank you for all who did help. We have, let's see, the men's breakfast coming up real quick on July 13th. Sign-ups are in the back. And we have a biblical dinner coming up on July 20th, later this month, 6 p.m. with Jay McCarl. It's a wonderful way to experience the food that was eaten during the time of our Lord. No reservations will be taken, and the $20 donation gets you a seat at the table. First come, first serve. Last day to purchase tickets will be next Sunday on the 14th. Let's see. I think that's it. With the exception of our sound people, diligent workers that they are now providing a DVD for the whole service if you want, up to 10 messages. So if you want like the last 9 weeks or 10 weeks or whatever, or if there's, who was the example you gave? Hanzi came, so if you wanted like Hanzi's message and whatever, that's totally doable. So DVDs are now available for $3. Yes, $3. So that is. Oh, and last thing, mid-July, baby bottle change fundraiser. Start gathering your change for that, for the pregnancy center. We do that donation starting in the middle of the month. So that's it. If we can have our ushers come forward for this morning's offering, if I got everything. Heavenly Father, we thank you again for this time. This is a motley crew that you put together, these believers. We are brothers and sisters, and we are just happy to be in your house. We are happy to be your kids. Bless this time, Lord, because we want to bless you. Bless the tithes and offering as we offer them to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning. Good morning. Anyways, let's turn to Proverbs chapter 31, verses 18 to 31. And we're talking about the virtuous wife. And it says, she perceives that her merchandise is good, her lamps does not go out by night. She stretches out her hands to the distaff, and her hand holds the spindle. She extends her hands to the poor. Yes, she reaches out her hands to the needy. She is not afraid of snow for her household, for all her household is clothed with scarlet. She makes tapestry for herself. Her clothing is fine linen and purple. Her husband is known in the gates when he sits among the elders of the land. She makes linen garments and sells them, and supplies sashes for the merchants. Strength and honor are her clothing. She shall rejoice in time to come. She opens her mouth with wisdom, and on her tongue is the law of kindness. She watches over the ways of her household and does not eat the bread of idleness. Her children rise up and call her blessed. Her husband also, and he praises her. Many daughters have done well, but you excel them all. Amen. Charm is deceitful, and beauty is passing. But a woman who fears the Lord, she shall be praised. Give her the fruit of her hand, and let her own works praise her in the gates. Amen. I tell you, many men here can say that about their wives. Today's my anniversary, and you know, amen. You know, a lot of times as guys, we don't read the instructions before we buy something. But I tell you, I read these instructions. I didn't throw them away. The Lord gave me a good wife. Amen. God bless you.
All nature and all created. behind the stone, lifted down, rejected and alone, like a rose trampled on the ground. You took the fall, thought of being above all, like a rose trampled on the ground. You took the fall. Not a being above
Glory be to our great God.
of lightning, rolls of thunder. Last seen in all its strength and glory and power be to you, the only wise King. Holy, 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 Son of God Almighty, was it is just to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Filled with wonder,
none like you. And we give honor, we defer our opinions, we defer our rights to ourselves to you and to your throne. Bless this time. Bless this time. Bless your word and keep out all the distractions. In Jesus' name, amen.
Worship team. Thank you, sound people, projectionists. Thank you, worshipers. Thank you, Jesus. Okay, a motley crew, Jeremy said. Now, I want to clarify that. There are two definitions for motley. One is a southern definition from the south and south of our country, not South America, but southern states. And that definition is someone who behaves badly in a humorous way. And a rascal. Well, that's not the motley that Jeremy's talking about. He's talking about the other dictionary definition, which is a dictionary definition. And that definition says a mixed group, different people, and that's the group that we are, a group that God put together. We had the building stones. We had message and how God just uses all different kinds of people to achieve his purpose, to build his building. And the stones are very different because they serve different purposes. Amen? Okay, I forgot my water. Randy, could you please get me a water from probably on my desk? This morning, let's pray. We're going to pray for some people, first of all. Thank you. We're going to pray for Hansi. Hansi's struggling. He had surgery. They took the cancer tumor out of his lymph nodes in his neck. He has a 6-inch incision. There was more than they expected. He's asked for our prayer because he doesn't want any nerve damage or vocal cord damage, of course, and they want him to do radiation. He doesn't really want to do radiation. He wants to believe in faith, but he's struggling that balance beam of, well, what's faith and what's stupid faith, as he puts it, and whether he should do it or not. He doesn't want to. They say that if he doesn't do it, it could be a problem because a couple of years down the line, it can come back and be untreatable. And so he's seeking our prayer and that we would join with him in prayer. We need to pray for Sherry. Sherry's had 3 surgeries and on her detached retina. Right now, it's like looking through frosted glass, but the doctors are saying within a couple of months, it should get better. We want to pray that it does get better. Amen. And we want to pray for Ed Dominguez, a live streamer who has some knee problems. We want to pray for Alice. She had swollen legs and problems this past week. And Cynthia, our sister Cynthia here, we pray for her. Lord, we come before you with all these physical needs and more, Lord. There's many more of people out there who have contacted us, people who are watching live stream right now. And we just pray, Lord, that we can count on you, Jehovah Jireh, Jehovah our healer, that you are provider, that you would provide our every need. And Father God, that people would be healed, people would be ministered to, and that it would be to the glory of your name, Lord. We thank you so much that we're able to come before you and pray for these things, Lord God. We ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. This morning we're in 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 9 and 10. If you don't have a Bible, raise your hand. We'll get a Bible to you. We also project the verse. A Royal Priesthood is the title. But before we get into this, I'd like to thank all of you for your support for the fireworks stand. We won't know what we exactly made until we get the numbers from Phantom, and it's like a phone bill when you get the numbers from Phantom where there's all these charges, and then I look at the charges and I say, what does that even mean? And last year I negotiated the charges and we got like $1,200 knocked off of them. And so, you know, we'll see what happens this year. But they'll sooner or later tell us. But you guys were amazing. You know, we had different things happen. We need to pray for Edgar and his finger. We pray for his finger that had 9 stitches and a 50% detached tendon, Lord, that was sewed back. And Father God, that he would get full use of that finger back. We thank you, Lord. But Edgar was put out of commission, and different ones for different reasons. Some I won't mention right now, but different reasons. But the thing is, it's kind of like one time Frederick the Great told one of his generals that he was sending 60,000 soldiers to the general for the battle against the enemy. And the general complained later that Frederick the Great had only sent him 50,000 and that he had been shorted 10,000 soldiers. And Frederick replied, I sent 50,000 men because I counted you, general, as 10,000. And so too the Lord counts you Christians as many, us Christians as many. Frederick put much faith in his general. But in God's economy, he is our general. In Judges chapter 6, Gideon had gathered an army of 32,000 men to fight the Midianites, who had an army of 135,000. Bad odds, 32,000 against 135,000. Any military man will tell you, statistically, that's just an impossible battle. But Jehovah said that it's too many. The Father God said too many because God didn't want Israel thinking that they were winning the battle. because they had this might. They had 32,000 guys, but they were all ninjas. They were all Green Berets. They were all Navy SEALs. And the 135 were merely foot soldiers, 135,000. And so God said no, and they might think that they didn't need God's help if they won on their own. And so he told Gideon, tell the men who are afraid to go home, to go back home. And 10,000 left immediately. But God said, still too many. Now there's 22,000 fighting men. And so then he said, well, all the men who drink with their face down, we'll let them go home also when they drink their water. I'll give you victory with 300 men who kept watch while they drank, he promised. And we know the story. They had the jugs with the lanterns in them, torches in them, and up on the hill, and confused the enemy, the Midianites, into thinking that they were many more, that they were 100,000, and the Midianites in their confusion were killing each other, and they fled. Well, so too, we weren't that many out there. We had the lions alongside of us, the Lions Club, that is, but they were like lions. And so we got the job done, we made it through, and now we'll see how much God provides. And he always provides. Amen. Now, in verse 9, 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9, we read, but you, who is you? Us, the church, the family of God, a chosen people, a nation. But you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood. Now, chosen generation we've been looking at for the past couple of few weeks, but a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people. Now, is that all special? Is that all taking us to a new level of who we are? We're a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, not just a priesthood, but a royal kingly priesthood. A holy nation, not America, but the church, his own special people, that you may proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. There's a contrast, if you ever had a contrast. Called out of your previous darkness into a marvelous light. Amen? Incredible stuff, awesome stuff. Weeks past, we looked at our citizenship, being as a chosen nation, as a chosen generation, a holy nation. This week, our emphasis will be the people who comprise his royal priesthood. Now, do you feel like royal priests this morning? I think you're all kind of like deer in headlights. Royal priest. Well, and that is more of a generic term. It's not, we know God's no respecter of persons. And so when we say priesthood, it includes everyone, not just men, but everyone. Amen? Peter states we are a royal priesthood, and we should identify with that. In verse 10, then in Acts chapter 10, verse 34, Acts 10, 34. Then Peter opened his mouth and said, in truth, I perceive that God shows no partiality. We are all part of this royal priesthood, people. And how greater can it be? Now, in the Old Testament, the priest, the high priest, was the highest person in the hierarchy of Israel. Higher than any politician, any business person. And so to call us part of a royal priesthood elevates us to the highest of places here on earth, the highest of people, of nations, of people groups here on earth. Now, don't get carried away with yourself, though, because even people in high places, as we know, can blow it, can not be good witnesses, and so on. And so, yes, this is what we're called to, But whether we achieve this or not, that can be another story. Is that so? But this was an incredible statement. Peter said, in God is no respecter, no of gender, of socioeconomics, of education, of any of that stuff. Each person is equal in God's sight. An incredible statement, especially in a day back then when the hierarchy and the social levels were so defined and so unbalanced. You had slaves, you had all kinds, lepers, you had all kinds of people, and beggars who just were looked at as lowly. And then you had those in government and those in the temple who were looked up to as being so high and mighty. And in between, there wasn't all that much. It wasn't like our great middle class here in America or even in Europe. But there was this disparity of position. And so in that time, to say that all were equal in God's eyes, God showing no partiality, that was an incredible thing. And then to call the church, to call us a royal priesthood. Now, priests have kind of lost their shine in this age, or the term priesthood, priest. But back then, everything revolved around the temple. I heard it from someone. Who said that? Jeremy. The temple. Chris, the temple. Everything revolved around the temple. And so, in that day, a priest meant something. Now, most of us hear the word priest and we think of a person with a white collar and a black shirt or long robes, colorful robes, oftentimes. Some might think of the Old Testament priest. Here we have an Old Testament priest being anointed. His ears are being anointed. And he's very colorful. He's got the ephod and the stones, and he has a hat, a turban, and all these embellishments. And that's the Old Testament priest in the Levitical priesthood, the priesthood of Aaron. Now, Aaron in the Levitical priesthood was an Old Testament priesthood. But here we have a New Testament truth, a new priesthood. In the New Testament verses that we have just read, we see where Peter, writing under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit himself, these are not Peter's thoughts, these are the thoughts of the Holy Spirit, says, we are a holy priesthood, a royal and holy priesthood. And of course, the balance beam would make, on one hand, unbalanced, it would make a priest someone who you have to go to connect with God. And we know that's wrong. And then if you tip it the other way, some go around thinking that, you know, well, I'm the priest and I'm the holy one and I'm better than everyone else. But there's a balance between the two. And the balance is that we are representatives of God Almighty and we come from royalty. There's a lot of talk about royalty in England right now with the newborns and whatnot, heirs to different royal positions in England. And it's big news, these babies being born and their names, Archibald or whatever. And people are eating it up. Well, we are royalty. Some people think, man, if only I could have been born to that family, that royal family, and been a Windsor or been a whatever, an Archibald. Whatever, things would have been different. Well, we are born into a higher royalty than that of England. Amen? That's what the Word of God says, not just Peter. That's what the Holy Spirit said through Peter. A new priesthood, a New Testament truth. In the New Testament verses, we see Peter writing under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. And the Word of God is the Word of God. You become part of the Lord's priestly family and a priest unto the Lord the day you're born again. That's how it works. Now, many Christians fail to recognize this. Many Christians fail to live like this. And then other Christians get a little out of control with it. And we're going to take over the whole world. We're going to take over the city of Sacramento. Dominion is ours. All the earth is ours. And we own it. And so we're to take it. Now, I was approached by a group of ministers in Sacramento and asked to join them in taking over the city of Sacramento. And I said, well, I understand and I respect, but you know, I'm having enough trouble in the little corner that God's given me. And I really don't feel, you know, like I can go and do this whole Sacramento city thing. Maybe if I grow or I get to the place where I feel like, these neighborhoods or whatever are taken care of, well, then maybe I can consider such a thing. And that they, you know, kind of looked at me funny, but they said, okay. But the very idea of being a priest bothers some people. It just bothers some people. And so think of it this way. You are the Lord's representative. The function of the priest was to stand before people to represent God and to stand before God on behalf of the people. And we do both these things. We stand before God to represent God. How? By witnessing. I was going to wait for this. Witnessing. By witnessing to people. That's how we represent God. By ministering to people. By sharing God's love, truth, and grace with people. That's how we do it. And we stand on behalf of people before God. How? This is tougher. I won't wait forever. Huh? Intercession. Intercessory praying. We pray for people. And we stand on behalf of God as we intercede for people. And I don't mean, oh, God, just smash that guy. You know, he really deserves it, Lord. What are you waiting for? The opportunity is golden today. He just did that. But I mean, hey, Lord, that person was abominable, and they just were so nasty and mean. And Lord, whatever it is inside of them that's causing them the pain to act like that in life and live like that, Lord, please remove it and replace it with the Holy Spirit. And Lord, if they're not saved, get them saved. If they are saved, get them to realize they're part of a royal priesthood, a chosen people, your people, Lord. That's what priestly ministry is all about. Peter's elevating our high position as a child of God one notch higher because God says so. We are God's family, the church, the body of Christ on earth, but we are a royal priesthood. Number one on your fill-in. We are a royal priesthood. We stand before people representing the Lord. Where do we do this? Where do we stand before people representing the Lord? Everywhere. Yeah, everywhere. Everywhere we stand or sit or lie down. Everywhere we eat. Everywhere we listen to music. Everywhere we are. Whether it be in the home, that's the first place, a priest in your family, standing before your spouse and kids as a visible, not invisible, visible. It's like, you know, oh, I don't tell my spouse I love them because they know I do. Why would I have married them if I didn't love them? Well, they need to hear it sometimes, I love you, amen? Visible, not invisible. We are a visible illustration to them of what the Lord is like because we have the Lord in us. We have the Holy Spirit in us. And at times, that can be a mortifying thought. At least for me, it is. I don't know about you. Knowing that they learn the Lord's heart by watching us, listening to us, seeing what's important to us and to the Lord. And sometimes we are not. We just plain are not the best examples. Amen? That doesn't mean that we give up. Doesn't mean that we don't keep chiseling away at the rough diamond to make it, at the sculpture, to make it come out looking like Christ. We not only represent the Lord at home, but in the world as well. The world is your pulpit, people. The world is your pulpit. Where you work, the teacher at your desk, the warehouse guy in the warehouse, the shop owner at the shop, the school, the student at the school. You are a priest representing the Lord to those who are around you. They know you're a Christian, hopefully. And that you're a priest everywhere. I talked a couple of weeks ago about the guy I knew who put the white collar and black shirt on because he thought that, you know, he was going to just be the royal priest. And then he went around Los Angeles where he was a pastor, a minister, and he gave it up after 2 weeks because so many people asked him for money and asked him for help that he, in prayer, that he just couldn't really get further than three blocks without his time being just used up. And so he gave it up. But we are a priest, and the privilege that we have as a priest is to stand before people on behalf of the Lord. We also get to stand before the Lord on the fact that we represent him and that we serve him. We're to be interceding for our nation, our community, our friends all the time. It's part of our calling, our function as priests. White collar shirt, one we should have, not visible, but invisible, but nonetheless. Now, I'm afraid that in some cases, with some believers, the only time they take the priestly calling seriously is on special occasions and events, like at family dinners. But as the Lord's priesthood, we are to constantly offer up prayers for family, friends, church, community, nation. Prayer should include all these things. When I say the Lord's Prayer, I, at one point, your kingdom come, I pray about the government. I pray for the city government. I pray for the state government. I pray for the national government. I pray for the world governments. It's a prayer that the Lord's Prayer was taken and broken down into different areas that made it possible to pray the prayer for 1 hour. And that was like in the 80s, and I still retain some of that. In verses 9 and 10, you get the idea that maybe we're special people, that the Lord really wants us to know how special we are, how privileged we are in him. Amen? And he reveals it by contrast with verse 10, telling us we once were in darkness, and when we were not in Christ, and now we are in Christ. Once in darkness, now in marvelous light. Marvelous light. We're not a people living in obscurity with no purpose for life, without a real identity, wondering why we're here. But now we become the people of God, his own chosen people, people for his own possession, a chosen generation, holy nation. One time, we were void of mercy, lost in our sins, hopelessly lost in our sins. Do you remember that time? I do. But now we become those who are chosen, those who are given grace. And by his grace, we've been shown mercy, God's undeserved, unmerited favor revealed to us in Christ Jesus. And I stand on mercy and grace and love. That's what I stand on. And then there's a responsibility. Made a royal priest. When I was made a minister, I took an oath. It was part of the ordination. And I said that I would spend the rest of my life fighting darkness and turning on the light of the Word in people's lives, that the Word would change the world. Same kind of thing a police officer takes, that a doctor takes, same kind of oaths, that you'll dedicate your life to doing all that you can to influence your community and your world, your family, your community, your world, for the good, not the bad. It's a big responsibility to be special in God's eyes when you realize who we're called to be. In Exodus chapter 29, we'll turn there, please. In Leviticus chapter 8, don't turn there. We're given an account of the ordination process of an Old Testament priest. This was the preparation they went through before entering into their priestly ministry in the Old Testament. Now, this serves as a wonderful picture of our calling and equipping by the Lord to be his representatives. I remember back in Bible college, the one professor, Ken Blumel, He pastored a church for years here. He was our favorite Old Testament professor because he would always spiritualize the Old Testament in the New Testament. He would bring out types and pictures using the Old Testament of how the Old Testament reflected the New Testament, how the Old Testament priest reflected Christ, how the Old Testament deliverers reflected Christ. And so he used that the most, and he became the most popular of the teachers. It's like sometimes, you know, some of them were just not that exciting, but Ken was always exciting. Ken always had us sitting at the edge of our chairs listening to his different analogies and whatnot. And it was just, you know, bringing the Old Testament to life, using earthly pictures or types to illustrate heavenly truths. Now, Exodus 29, verses 1 through 9. And this is what you shall do to them. Now, to them was to the priests. And it was those who were ordaining the priests who would do this to them. To hallow them for ministering to me as priests. Take one young bull and two rams without blemish. And unleavened bread, unleavened cakes mixed with oil, and unleavened wafers anointed with oil. You shall make them of wheat flour. You shall put them in one basket and bring them in the basket with the bull and the two rams. And Aaron, we know the Levitical priesthood was Aaron's priesthood, and Aaron and his sons you shall bring to the door of the tabernacle of meeting, and you shall wash them with water. Then you shall take the garments, put the tunic on Aaron, and the robe of the ephod, and the breastplate, and gird him with the intricately woven band of the ephod. These are all things that are being done to Aaron the priest. He's not doing them himself. They're being done to him. You shall put the turban or hat on his head and put the holy crown on the turban. And you shall take the anointing oil. And it wasn't just a little drop like we do, or where we put a cross on the forehead or whatever, but it was a good amount of oil. And you shall take the anointing oil, pour it on his head, and anoint him. Then you shall bring his sons and put tunics on them. And you shall gird them with sashes, Aaron and his sons, and put the hats on them. The priesthood shall be theirs for a perpetual statute. So you shall consecrate Aaron and his sons. Exodus 29, 1 through 9, Old Testament priesthood. Now we want to notice that there were at least five things done to them. There were more than five things, but I don't have time this morning. I'm running out of time right now to talk about them all. At least five things done to Aaron and his sons to separate them to the office of the priest. And the emphasis for us is that they were done to Aaron and his sons, not done by Aaron and his sons. They were not doing something that earned them the right to minister. There was something being done to them that anointed them, that allowed them to minister. Many people think that for God to choose you, to choose us, that we have to be successful in getting our lives together. That we have to become a Bible scholar. Pastor Chuck Smith was never a theologian. He never claimed to be. But God used him in an incredible way to start thousands of churches here on earth. We don't need a degree. We don't need to eliminate all sin in our life to be used by God. Now, of course, we have to keep that in balance. We can't say, oh, you know, I'm this backslider who's drunk all the time, who does all these different things, who womanizes or whatever, and has affairs, and, you know, but God will still use me. You know, that just doesn't make it. That, of course, if you have any common sense, you realize that is not a good thing, because God may use you, but he may use you by axing your head off and saying, oh, there's a good example of what happens when you're backslidden. But our being used by the Lord is really a matter of his grace and calling us based on his unmerited, unearned favor, his grace. Which is totally my story for the past 34 years. You know, I came to Christ, and by his grace, I got in with the Calvary Chapel bunch, and, you know, talk about a motley crew. And, you know, the first couple of generations of Calvary Chapel, we were a motley crew. And I was not really Bible literate. People, because of an anointing that I didn't even realize I had, people would come to me and ask me for advice, Christians at church. And here, you know, I'd only been a Christian for maybe 3 months. Steve Powell, Mary Powell's, maybe some of you remember Mary Powell. She was one of the first members of the church. Well, her son came to me one time and said, Ken, you know, I need some advice. And what it is my wife has taken off and left me and moved in with a drug dealer. And I said, well, you know, you've always told me how your wife is so ungodly and whatnot and how she treats you terribly. Well, it looks like this is your good opportunity. She's committed fornication, yeah. And so you're sure, yeah. And so this may be a good time for you to get someone else. And he goes, oh, okay. And so then what does he do? He goes to my good friend, Sam Allen, who pastors Calvary Chapel Chico, and he says, Sam, you know, Ken said that this. And Sam comes to me and says, Ken, what did you tell Steve? And I said, what? And he said, Steve says you told him that now, you know, because his wife is off fornicating and has committed adultery, that the only problem, Ken, is they're not divorced, is that now he can go find someone else, a good Christian woman. I said, yeah. He goes, oh, no. But God still used me. Pastor Chuck put it this way, where God guides, he provides. Now, number one on the Old Testament priesthood, which is actually number two on your fill-in, is that they were brought to the door. They were brought to the door. We've been brought to the door. We've been brought to Jesus. Amen? John 6:44. No one can come to me. No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up at the last day. So much for we were seeking God. It's God sought us. Yes, we may have been in bad shape and we were looking, but in the end, the bottom line is the biblical truth. Your coming to Christ began with the Lord by His Spirit drawing you to Him, by convicting you of your sin, showing you had a need for a Savior through the work of the Holy Spirit. Now you had to respond. You did, to that drawing by placing your faith in Jesus and opening up your heart, but He was the one. We can say, as we always say in Calvary Chapel, He chose us because He knew we would choose Him from the foundation of the earth. Now maybe the Spirit is drawing you today because you know that you have been far from a royal priest. And the Holy Spirit is speaking to you. So first, they were brought to the door. And the Holy Spirit's bringing all of us to the door daily. Daily. But it's number two. Number three, on your fill-in, they were cleansed. In verse 4, they were cleansed. And you shall wash them with water. This symbolized being purified from all uncleanliness. So too, the first thing the Lord does to us when we come to Him is He being our high priest, He cleanses us from all of our sin. Nothing that we do. He does it. He does the cleansing. The water speaks of the Lord Jesus Christ, transforming the life of the believer through the Word of God, through the urging of the Holy Spirit, through the dagger, the little dagger that the Holy Spirit keeps sticking in us. Sometimes it's more like a sword. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, for this reason we also thank God without ceasing, we're told. For what reason? Because when you received the word of God which you heard from us, you welcomed it not as the word of men, but as it is in truth the word of God, which also effectively works in you who believe. Effectively, efficiently works in you who believe. It works. The Word of God works. That word effectively translated shows itself mighty in work. It is a power word of action. The Word of God is alive and has a powerful transforming work in our lives when our hearts are open to it. You know the drill. You tell someone, don't do this, don't do that. You see that they're out there cheating on their spouse, and you tell them this is going to end badly, and they just won't listen. They won't listen. Why? Because their heart is hard. Their heart is closed. And until they open their heart, the Lord's Word and the Holy Spirit won't change them. To serve the Lord, we need to be washed from self-wisdom. Jesus will use His Word to accomplish that work in you that He desires. And what I told Steve Powell, that was self-wisdom. In the world, that was the word of the world. Yeah, well, man, she's out there doing that with this drug dealer. And so, you know, now you're free. Go find a good Christian woman. That was worldly wisdom. It just needed a little attachment of biblical to it. Get divorced first. That was all. But that was a big all. Amen? And that's what he ended up doing. And then he found himself no one. He ended up staying unmarried for the rest of his time. But that was the Lord, how the Lord worked. Isaiah 55:11. So shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth. It shall not return to me void. This is the scripture we talk about all the time. The word shall not return void. But it shall accomplish what I please, and it shall prosper in the thing for which I sent it. The thing in which I sent it. To serve the Lord, we need to be washed. We need to be in the Word of God. Number four on our fill-in. They were divinely clothed in verse 5. 29:5, Exodus 29:5. They were divinely clothed. Then you shall take the garments, put the tunic on Aaron and the robe of the ephod and the breastplate, and gird him with the intricately woven band of the ephod. All this is being done to them. Now, I don't have time to go into every aspect of the clothing because there are so many. Don't have time to mention why Aaron the high priest's garments were different from his son's garments. To us, Jesus is high priest. We are his sons. Coats speak of our righteousness. Isaiah 61:10. I will greatly rejoice with the Lord. My soul shall be joyful in my God, for he has clothed me with the garments of salvation. He has covered me with the robe of righteousness. As a bridegroom decks himself out with ornaments, and as a bride adorns herself with her jewels. God's put the spiritual clothing on us. It's invisible. One day it'll be visible in heaven. But we come to minister before the Lord. We don't come in our own self-righteousness. We come in His righteousness. Amen? And in righteousness that's been imputed to us from the Lord. And the Father sees us in His Son. And His righteousness covers us like a robe. I always use the example, take a dirty rag or dirty, filthy piece of paper, put it in your Bible. What do you see? You see the Bible. You don't see the dirty, filthy rag. Same thing. God sees us clothed in righteousness, the righteousness of His Son. And one day we'll stand before the Lord in the righteous robes He provides as His brides. Zechariah 3:3-4. Now Joshua was clothed with filthy garments and was standing before the angel. So at one time Joshua is in filthy garments. And then in verse 4, then he answered and spoke to those who stood before him, saying, take away the filthy garments from him. And to him he said, see, I have removed your iniquity from you, and I will clothe you with rich robes. That's us. We're in filthy clothing, and then God put nice clean clothes on us. Sometimes we go through life exposed, displaying ugly, sharp words and critical attitudes, bad behavior, rascals, Southern motley people. But what we see is not what God sees clothed in His righteousness. The belt, the girdle, in the priest case, it was a sash, a big belt that tied in front. People wore robes, and we talked about how they needed to be girded up. They needed to pull up their robes and be girded to run or to work. The girdle speaks of The girding speaks of freedom, of service, and usefulness. In John 8, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Well, the girding, we talked about that in weeks past. Jesus has set us free out of the bondage of sin, and knowing our place in Him gives us confidence to serve. Amazing that God likes to use us. Same way that I would take my young kids out and they, we would do things together, maybe plant something or whatever, but having them there, it took three times as long. But it taught them, and it was fun just being with them. So too, God lets us do things. He could do it so much better, so much quicker. He doesn't need us to pray for healing for people. None of that. But He uses us. Turban, hats, head covering. Exodus 28, for Aaron's sons, you shall make tunics, and you shall make sashes for them. You shall make hats for them for glory and beauty. Psalm 90. Let your work appear to your servants and your glory to their children. And let the beauty of the Lord our God be upon us and establish the work of our hands for us. Yes, establish the work of our hands. How's the work of your hands? Are your hands open to people daily? Or are they closed and holding your possessions, holding your things, holding your love, holding all that is important to you? Or do you have open hands? Do you have open hands to the Lord when He asks you to do something, when He tells you to do something? Or do you have tight fists? Truly, our Lord has put upon His people His own glory and beauty. We are not merely acceptable, but beloved. Not just acceptable, but beloved. Not passable, not just, oh, we make it, but should be admirable. We are not only under no condemnation, but God has imparted to us a holiness, a beauty, a loveliness of a bride or a groom decked out, and He has clothed us. It's not that we have clothed ourselves, because you will always come up with mismatched colors. You will always come up with a shirt that's not buttoned right when you clothe yourself. Jesus so much falls in love with us and with He who is in us. The image of Him, His own being, that His heart is captured. And there's the glory and the beauty which He has invested in us. And every believer is looked upon by God as if He were Christ. We're not Christ, but as if, because we're His son. How do I look at my grandchildren? Well, I look at my children as lovely, beautiful, and important to me. I'd die for any of my kids, either of my two daughters. If there was a guy with a gun, I would jump in front of my kid and take the bullet rather than my kid taking it. If they were drowning, I would jump in the water even though I can't swim and try to save them. That's just how it is. That's built into us. Well, when God looks, and my grandkids, even more so probably, and when God looks at us, what He sees is He sees His son's kids. Christ took our place and was cursed for us. And now we take His place on here as the body of Christ. And with all the blemishes, all the backslidings and backbitings, all the hardness that you may feel within, if you're truly in Christ, you are so clothed that glory and beauty and the divine is yours. Amen? Number five, our last point, Exodus 29, verse 7. Oh, we have six. They were anointed. They were anointed. I'm looking at the time and I'm saying, oh, there's only five, but there are six. This speaks of the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Zechariah 4, 6, not by might nor by power, but by my Spirit, says the Lord of hosts. There is an empowering that must accompany any calling. Without that anointing, you cannot survive. You cannot be effective. God should speak to you. You should hear, and others confirm. Witness in the world of the apostles. Well, they were witnesses. be my witnesses when in that world? After you're baptized in the Spirit. It's the same for us. Why is it that a person who's unlearned and not eloquent, and I've seen it many times, can share the word and God can respond to them in this gigantic way? I've known pastors who didn't know the Bible. They were Bible illiterate, but they preached, and Raul Reese was an example. In the beginning, Raul Reese, man, his theology was so bad. It was really nasty bad, heretical bad. And yet all these people came. Now he's got, you know, because of that beginning, he went kind of the opposite extreme, and now he has a doctorate in theology, and his theology is good. But why did God use him? Because that's how God works. Amen? Maybe another man has more natural qualifications and can share on a subject in a much better way, but if the anointing is not there, it just doesn't work. Ministry is not a matter of I want to, I study hard. It's an anointing, being energized by the Spirit, but we're all priests. It allows the ordinary to do the extraordinary. Extraordinary. Peter and the apostles were the perfect example. Exodus chapter 29, verse 20. Then you shall kill the ram and take some of its blood and put it on the tip of the right ear of Aaron and on the tip of the right ear of his sons and on the thumb of their right hand and on the big toe of their right foot and sprinkle the blood all around on the altar. Picture of the priest being anointed and his ears being anointed with the blood, please. Blood placed on the right ear, right thumb, and right big toe, symbolizing covering and possession. Jesus purchased us with his blood. He owns us. Our body belongs to him. Amen. Our life belongs to him. Every part. His ears, the things that he hears. To his thumb, his hand, his activity, the things that he does. To his feet, lifestyle, the way that we walk. Hands, feet, ears. There were all kinds of spiritual things that took place during the fireworks. One was I got my big toe anointed on my right foot. First, I put a wrong pair of athletic shoes on, and by the end of the day, halfway through the day, my feet were killing me. And I took the shoe off, the athletic shoe off, and my big toe, the toenail was blue, dark blue, the whole toenail. But then, I needed more anointing. And so I had the 4x4 sandwich board signs that I put out in the morning. Well, when you put them out, you've got two on the big dolly that we have there, and they're very awkward. And when you take one off, the other just doesn't want to cooperate and stay balanced on that dolly and sometimes falls over. Well, two or three times the sandwich board fell over, and the corner, and that thing weighs a lot, and the corner of that sandwich board on my big toe, on the right foot. So, yeah, more anointing. A lot of anointing out there. But we have to be brought, but the application is there, the covering is there, the anointing is there, it's in the picture. Did we get the picture of the ears of the priest being anointed? A person who's been brought to Jesus, washed and transformed by the word, called and equipped, is anointed and empowered with the Spirit, still needs to have the blood applied to their life. Why? Because we constantly need to be cleansed. Amen? I don't always hear the Lord as clearly as I should. I don't reach out with my hands open as warmly or as much as I should. I don't walk as correctly as I should while I'm ministering. And the blood applied before they went into the service, and it was applied when they came out. And we can't really be effective without the cleansing of the blood of Jesus Christ, removing the stench, the stain, and the stink of our sins. Amen? And then when you're through ministering, you need the blood, because after ministry, we're vulnerable to one of two things. It happens to me almost every week. The flesh, after a sermon, I'm tempted to either get puffed up or to get put down. If effective, wow, I had got that one together. You know, it was smooth, it was cohesive, it had every component that I'd like to find, history and the Holy Spirit and, you know, the Word and accurate and all these different components, stories, a couple of jokes. And so then that one went well. If ineffective, and sometimes everybody switches it up on me, it turns it upside down. The one I think was ineffective, they say, oh, that was great. And the one I thought was so great, they say, I don't hear anything. But ineffective, then I go home and it's, wow, did I blow that one? Man, I left out, I just skipped over, I ran out of time. I had to skip over my best illustration. I didn't get to tie it all up at the end because I ran out of time. Well, the blood needs to be applied in either case. Hey, it's the Lord, it's the Holy Spirit going out. Not me. Number six, their hands were filled. Their hands were filled on our fill-in. In Exodus 29:24, their hands were filled. What were they filled with? All kinds of things. Take the fat of the ram, the fat tail, the fat that covers the entrails, the fatty lobe attached to the liver, the two kidneys and the fat on them, the right thigh, for it is as a ram of consecration. One loaf of bread, only one loaf of bread for all that. One cake made with oil and one wafer from the basket of the unleavened bread that is before the Lord. And you shall put all these in the hands. You shall put them in the hands of Aaron and in the hands of his sons, and you shall wave them as a wave offering before the Lord. You shall receive them back from their hands and burn them on the altar as a burnt offering, as a sweet offering before the Lord. It's an offering made by the fire to the Lord. There you have it, the wave offering. Note, the Lord filled their hands. They did not fill their own. All we have to give to the Lord is from him in the first place. Amen. And John the Baptist said it in John chapter 3. John answered and said, a man can receive nothing unless it has been given to him from heaven. Do you believe that? Well, then walk it. In James 1, every good gift and every perfect gift is from above and comes down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow of turning. And we live in a marvelous, what? Light. All the scriptures, in the end, after all that's done to them, they offer up their spiritual sacrifices. They offer up their heart in Psalm 51. They offer up their body in Romans 12:1. The sacrifice of, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. It's reasonable to ask of you. Next one. Indeed, I have all and abound. I am full, having received from Epaphroditus the things sent from you, a sweet-smelling aroma, an acceptable sacrifice, well-pleasing to God. Giving it back to God. And Philippians, okay, we've done Philippians, Hebrews. Our service, okay, our heart, our body, our service, our worship, Hebrews 13. Therefore, by him, let us continually offer the sacrifice of praise to God, that is, the fruit of our lips, giving thanks to his name. Let's pray. Lord God, we come before you. And Lord, I just pray that the family here, the chosen nation, the chosen family, the royal priesthood, that we would leave here knowing who we are, Lord, and taking that and acting upon that and acting like royalty. Because a good part of it is, if you're in England and you were chosen to be part of that royal family, the eyes are upon you at all times. The paparazzi are watching, waiting to get a picture of you. And actually, the picture they want is in some compromising, some embarrassing situation. That's the picture they're really looking for. And so too, Lord, it is with this royal priesthood that we belong to. The world is just watching and looking at us and waiting for us to blow it so they can say, ah, Christian, who tries to preach to me, look how you behave. Look what you do. Look at who you are. And Lord God, we don't want that. Lord, yes, we're going to make mistakes. And yes, we can tell them we're not perfect, Lord. But Father God, we don't want to be condoning imperfection either. We want to acknowledge it. We want to pray, lift it up to you, and have the work done on us. Be changed, be transformed, have new hearts, have transformed minds, all that good stuff. And Father God, when we have all that and we apply the word to it and the Holy Spirit energizes it, the world doesn't get the picture that's embarrassing or compromising. Instead, we end up glorifying you in your holy name. We pray in Jesus' name. If anyone out there in live stream world doesn't know Jesus, doesn't know you, Lord, let them from this word realize that they can be a holy priest, a high priest, a royal priest in your kingdom as well, a member of your family, chosen nation. We pray in Jesus' name, and everyone said, amen. All right, people. Lord bless you. Do we have some music?